Hey guys, welcome back to Andy's Corner HVAC. I wanted to take a minute to say thank you to all the current and future subscribers out there. You know, over the years, we've gotten to talk to all kinds of people all over the place. We've worked through a lot of stuff, so hopefully we're doing some good. That's why we do these videos, and that's what the channel is all about. So if you're new to the channel, go ahead and check it out. There's all kinds of videos on there about all kinds of different stuff. There's places on there where you can get a hold of me, leave me messages, things like that. While you're there, do me a favor and hit the subscribe button because that helps us out a lot. And go ahead and hit the bell icon that way you get notifications every time a new video comes out. And because I am a YouTuber, as always, we always ask if you like the videos, give it a big thumbs up because that's just what YouTubers ask for. Also, I wanted to let everybody know that the new books are available on Amazon. The link will be in the description below. It's a pretty short read. Pretty cheap, inexpensive book, but there's a lot of information in there. So check it out. Leave me a review. Let me know what you think. Otherwise, on to the video. All right, guys. Today I wanted to talk to you about furnaces, which if you're a regular to the channel, you know we talk about furnaces pretty often. But specifically, today I want to talk about gas furnaces with a generator. Now, I want to get it out there right up front. That way there's not a million questions. I'm talking a gas furnace. I don't care if it's an LP furnace, natural gas furnace, even if you've got an oil furnace. We can probably do the same thing with it, too. But if you're talking, you've got an all-electric home, you've got geothermal, you've got an electric air handler, you've got an electric air handler with a heat pump, something like that, I would strongly suggest you talk to an electrician and have a whole home generator, like a standby generator put in. That's going to be able to do a lot more than what some of these portables were. What I'm talking about, because I get a lot of questions about it, because so many people have portable generators, right? And so many people, when the power goes out, try to plug these things in, and they don't work. Modern furnaces, modern gas furnaces, are very specific about their voltage that comes into them. You know, they have sophisticated control boards in them and all kinds of things like that now, so we have to be careful. It looks for any kind of dirty voltage. It looks for reverse polarity. It looks for lack of grounding. There's so many things in there that these furnaces look for, and they have to have good power coming to them. So one of the solutions you can do is make sure you always have a good ground. You know, that makes sense, right? I would think that would be common sense, but I talk to a lot of people that they're trying to run a generator and they don't have the thing grounded. You know, a lot of people look at a generator as being grounded because, well, they plug a cord into it that's got three wires or three prongs on it, and, well, that little round one down at the bottom, well, that's the ground. Well, it is, but if the generator itself's not grounded, then that power going in is not grounded, which means if you hook a furnace to it, or even if you hook a refrigerator or a freezer or something like that, some other appliance in the house to it, you're not grounded if that generator itself is not grounded. So I want to show you a way that you can keep that thing grounded to your main house ground without running any risk of backfeeding voltage into the breaker box, because we definitely don't want that. That's a major no-no. So we do not want to backfeed the breaker boxes. We want to keep everything separate because we don't want to take a chance of hurting anybody out there. And as always, there's always a disclaimer that says, you know, this electrical work is always recommended by Andy's Corner HVAC to be done by a qualified, certified electrician, and homeowners should not be attempting this on their own. So, that being said, on to how you do this on your own. What we're going to use here is a three-way switch. Now, you've seen these at Menards and different places like that, but it's like a light switch, sort of, but it's got three prongs on it. Two up top and one down here on the bottom. Now, these three-way switches allow power to come from different places, and we distribute which way it goes by flipping the switch up or down. Whenever I put these in personally, I always mount them with the switch up and down. That way, it looks like a light switch. Up is normally on, down is normally off, just like your light switch in your home would be. So I would mount it on the furnace the same way. Obviously, you need to mount this in a conduited box. It needs to be sealed. It needs to be approved by all the codes in your area. I can't tell you right now where you're at or where all your what all your codes say they have to be, but make sure you always follow all the electrical safety codes because we don't want anybody getting hurt out there. So if these switches, they're pretty simple, really, but what they are is, since, like I said, it'll allow you to bring power in from a couple different places. Let's put it this way, maybe you can see it better. We've got a prong down here, and notice that one's black. Most of these three-way switches are that way. So you got a black one, and you got two brass ones up here. Now your black one, that's what normally they call your common. That is what your device is gonna be powering. Whenever I put these in, I always put it so the black screw is on the bottom, not on the top. The only reason I do that is because it makes sense in my head, and that's how I remember it. That way I wire it correctly every time without having to look at any kind of schematic or anything like that. Here in a few minutes, I'll show you what the schematic for it looks like. But after you do this once or twice, you should be able to do it on a pretty regular basis while doing it, because it's very simple. So that black screw, you're going to hook your furnace power to it. So what you're going to do is you've got power coming in from the house, and it goes to, if everything was done correctly, it'll go to an SSU switch, which is basically another switch with a fuse in it. Well, where that power comes in from the house, you're going to break that power. Now, obviously, you need to turn all the power off when you're doing this. Don't be trying to do this live. Don't hurt yourself. If you don't know to turn the power off, you should probably not be doing this. So shut your power off. And then we're going to have to break that line. What you're going to do is that black wire that comes from the furnace itself to actually power the furnace, should be 120 volts, that's going to go to your black screw. So screw that one on, so put that one on there. Obviously, do all your connections right, nice, clean, tight connections, everything like that. Now, the important part is your two brass ones up here. Now, whenever this switch is up, that is going to pass power directly from the black one to the brass one directly above it. If you want to, what I would do, because you never know what brand of switch, most of them I believe are the same, but there could be some different ones out there, is you can take an ohm meter and put it on both of those, and when you're up, it shows continuity. That means up closes this terminal to this terminal. When it goes down, it'll be this terminal to this terminal. So that way it breaks and comes from somewhere different. But your furnace wire has to be on the black one. That way it goes, that's what is going to the furnace, and you get power regardless which terminal you're powering up there. So, take that one to your furnace, and now the one up here on top that is directly above it that has continuity whenever the switch is up, that is going to be your main power coming to the house. So that way, whenever the switch is up, just like normal operation, power is going to come straight from the house to this switch, pass through the switch, and onto the furnace to power your furnace. Your neutral wire and your ground wire will already be hooked up. Whenever you do all this, one of the main things you have to make sure you do is that all the neutrals and all the grounds are connected together and stay connected to the breaker box. That way you have a good earth ground no matter what your power and everything with. So that one goes to main power from the house. Now this one over here, that one is going to be your generator plug. What I normally do, I thought I had it ready, but I apparently dropped it, is what you need is a male plug. Looks like that, because obviously if you start up your generator outside, which again, another one of those weird disclaimers that I feel like I have to put in there right now, is if you have a gas generator, put it outside, don't put it in the house. I've heard stupid stories of people trying to run one in the house and then a bunch of people die. Don't go dying from this video. At this point, Andy's Corner HVAC is not responsible for the death or injury of any individual here. That disclaimer's out there, you heard it. Use a qualified electrician, all that kind of stuff. But you've got your generator running outside, or don't have it running yet, but you've got it running outside or sitting outside, and you're going to have an extension cord that you run from outside to inside. So whenever you plug your cord into that generator, you're pushing a male plug in, right? So that means the cord you bring in is going to be a female plug. So at that point, from our switch, we need a male plug. So you can go get you a male plug. You can use a piece of Romex wire. I've done that a lot. You can use... if you have a heavy extension cord, I would not recommend going below 12 gauge wire. So if you have a heavy extension cord or a plug of some sorts, have a male plug, and you know, whenever you mount this switch in the box, out of the side of it, you can have a Romex connector or whatever you have, and you know, have that, and just have a pigtail of, you know, I usually leave 8 inches, 8 to 10 inches of that cord sticking out, so then you have a cord. Because once you do that, and you connect that to the opposite side of your black one, right there, once you do that, whenever you flip that switch down, now you are connecting your lead that's connected to the furnace and your generator plug. That way, when the power comes in from your generator, it is going to go straight to the switch and straight on down and into the furnace, and your furnace will run just like normal. The key to this, and the whole reason that we are doing this, is because the main ground from your breaker box will still be hooked up in the breaker box, and you're not breaking that. You want to make sure that is connected to your plug that you wire in. You want to make sure the ground is hooked up to your plug that you're wiring in, and the ground is going straight from the electrical panel to the furnace. That way you have a good earth ground no matter where your power is coming from. Obviously, again, you're going to have to put that in a box. You're going to want to put a nice cover on it and all that kind of stuff. And you're going to have this little cord hanging out. What I do a lot of times, you got a male cord hanging out, and for some reason that freaks people out. There's no power there. Even if the switch is up or if the switch is down, if you don't have a generator hooked to it, there's no power to it. You're never going to pass power there. But those prongs sticking out do freak people out sometimes. So what I do is whenever I get a male plug, I go ahead and get a female plug too and just plug them together. And that way, whenever they bring your extension cord in, you just pop the extra female plug off of there. Your plug is exposed. Now you can plug it in and restart your furnace. The biggest thing is the ground. That is what you have to do. But I wanted to put that out there because I see so many cases of people trying to run these portable gas generators with their furnace. And I've seen people take, they rip the SSU switch out and just run wires in there and wire nut wires together. I get it. It's an emergency. The power went out. The house is going to get cold. You have to get it up and running. I get it. But one of the big things is be proactive. Get it done before the power goes out. Don't worry. Don't procrastinate and do nothing about it until the day before the storm, because then you're gonna be freaking out trying to get it done. Get it done now. You know, most of my stuff, like electrical stuff at home that I'm preparing for the winter, I do it in the summer. For one, it's nice out, it's a good season to do it, and two, it's already done, so I'm not stressed out trying to do it when the storm is coming or the storm is here. So like I said, I am going to post the wiring diagram. That way you can see it, and it's just a hand drawn. It's nothing fancy, but I am going to post that on there just right after the video here. So make sure you check that out. Wire it correctly. Test it and make sure it works before the storm comes. But if you do follow that wire schematic, you're not going to get hurt. You're not going to hurt anybody. You know, it's going to be safe and it's going to be good for the furnace. Because one of the biggest things with these generators is if you put poor voltage to that furnace, you can hurt that board in that furnace. And then you're talking several hundred bucks to fix the furnace just because you're trying to run a generator and all you wanted to do is stay warm. So get it done before it gets cold. Get it done before it storms. Do it this way and you won't have any problems. So if you have any questions or comments or concerns or anything like that, hit me up in the comments as always. If you're not subscribed, go ahead and do so. It helps us out a lot. Hit the bell icon. That way you get notifications every time a new video comes out. And because I am a YouTuber, and we always ask, give it a big thumbs up if you liked the video. If you give it a thumbs down and you don't like the video, just don't worry about it. You don't have to do that one. But if you did like it, give it a thumbs up and be sure to subscribe. And anything, hit me up. Thank you and God bless.